In the 1800s, the town of Stavanger in Norway was booming. Its plentiful waterways yielded unbelievable quantities of fish, namely herring. It is said that the region was built on herring bones, but due to overfishing, this seemingly endless supply dried up towards the end of the century, causing many bankruptcies. Nature gave a new lease of prosperity to this Northland in the early 1900s. The brisling, or sardine as it's called after canning, were discovered in the deep fjords and a new boom began. In the 1960s, history repeated itself and hard times hit the region once again. Today, Stavanger is Norway's oil capital. The revenue this industry brought, along with tourism, has enabled this town to thrive once again. Over 1,000 years ago, Stavanger and towns just like it were the perfect Viking lairs. For these trading and hunting people, the fields corresponded to our road network. Their fast vessels made short work of the distance between the mountain realm and open ocean. The steep-sided fields were also good hiding places, and it was easy to spot unwanted guests approaching. People thought twice about sailing into such natural traps. Today, a different kind of adventurer seeks out these remote fields, and a different kind of danger awaits them. Lisabodden is a small settlement at the end of the fjord called Lisafjord. In the winter, the population is around 50, just enough to man the power plant and take care of local municipal chores. For the summer months, the ferry from Stavanger brings tourists, people with a love for nature and the outdoors. They come to hike and rock climb, kayak through the waterways, or simply marvel at these magnificent fjords. There is a campsite here owned and operated by Ivar Jasso. In these past few years, his quiet little business has had a small but steady increase in revenue due to base jumpers. If a surfer wanted the ultimate wave, he would probably head for Hawaii. For a base jumper, it's Norway, with Lisabotn being the North Shore and the cliff called Girard being pipeline.
Norway is my favorite place. I've been here, 5 years in a row now. And it just doesn't get boring. Both the country and people here are the most wonderful.
IFAR provides a shuttle service for the jumpers. When everyone has their base rigs packed and is ready to go, he drives them to the trail where the strenuous 2-hour hike begins. The road is winding and steep, and Ivar's van labors slowly. As the van departs, it's a mixture of relief to have survived the perilous drive and apprehension in anticipation of the jump ahead. The hike is physically demanding and technically challenging. The terrain changes constantly as you climb. You have to strike a balance with the clothing you take. You want to be prepared for the frequent and unpredictable changes in weather, yet not so encumbered that the jump will be affected. Almost impossible requirements. There is plenty of pure snow-melted water to drink along the way. The weather changes again. And again. And again. The hike is almost over as we near the exit point. The most perplexing question about base jumping is why do people do it?
All right, see you down there.
Have a good one, man.
What drives someone to seemingly risk their life for a thrill? Injuries and even fatalities are not unheard of. So why do these few adventurers do it? And what kind of people base jump?
For me, it's a freedom and a flight. When I jump, I don't really fall down, I fly. And now that I started flying wingsuits, it's a pure human flight, the best possible.
It basically changed the entire path of my life. When I was about 16 years old, was the first time I was exposed to base jumping. I could tell from the first time I saw it that it was something that I wanted to do and that I had to do. Through the next 2 years of my life, I spent basically learning as much as I possibly could about the sport. By the time I was 18, I found that I needed to skydive in order to learn to base jump. So I started skydiving. And it basically changed everything. It changed the way I saw the world. It changed the way I saw my life. It changed the way I saw people's lives around me. And I actually found a form of happiness that I had never felt before in my entire life. Base jumping has given me more than anything else I have ever experienced. So has it changed my life? I say base jumping has given me a life.
It made my life much better. It helped me to get out of bad moods and depressions and stuff like that. It also teaches you how to deal with fear and stress. You have to act correctly in a very stressful situation. That skill is just the most important thing you can learn in life.
The friendships that I've made base jumping are by far the strongest friendships I've ever had. Before base jumping, I kind of had difficulty communicating with other people, and I really didn't have very many friends. Once I started base jumping and the people who I met, it's hard to describe, but you have this common bond that draw you together, and you become almost like brothers, almost instantaneously. I have made friends in a matter of moments that have become basically lifelong friends.
I've been flying them for about 2 years now, and it turns out to be a perfect mix of jumping and flying. Base jumping is a beautiful sport, but I always wanted to fly, and pure flying, like paragliders or airplanes, it was a little bit too slow for me. Wingsuits are a perfect mix that lets you go as fast as you want. It's like a jet version of hang gliding. It's a perfect mix of base jumping and the flight. you get both at the same time, and it's just excellent.
But as far as the jump is concerned, for maybe the first 2 to 3 seconds, it's primarily the same thing. You're in dead air, you know, just dropping. As you start moving through the third second, you start gaining more air, filling your wings, and you start getting movement. And you start getting this sensation of being lifted, and actual sensation of flight. Because you actually are watching, instead of just watching the ground come up at you, you're actually watching the ground move underneath you. So you're traveling, and the ground's moving underneath you, you're moving forwards, and it actually is more of a sensation of flying.
There is a lot of fear, and I like it at all. It's very psychological. If you look at people, at your buddies at the exit point, especially at some really nasty, scary jump, their personalities change. Everybody changes at the exit point. You look at people and they're totally different human beings. I know that myself, I change a lot at the exit point. And that's a fun part. You just have to deal with your fear, and you have to do the right things real quick as you are stressed out and scared. That's fun.
I am scared every single time I do a jump. It's not really a negative thing for me, the kind of fear that I get from base jumping. I have it every single time, and it keeps my senses, and it keeps me aware, and it keeps me from hurting myself, and it keeps me out of excessive danger. And what it does is it heightens my ability to see what's going on around me. And I experience it, I accept it, and I deal with it. It's not really not having fear, it's about controlling fear and not allowing fear to control you. And that's kind of how I see base jumping and the fear that I have while doing it. It's a matter of being able to control it.
The locals here love base jumpers. The ferry from Stavanger makes a scheduled stop en route to watch the jumpers. This is arranged via radio contact with the captain. We land on an isolated peninsula. The only way back is by boat, and Ivar's staff again shuttle us. As we take the boat ride back through the fjord, it's a time for reflection. The journey here was long. The flight to Norway, the taxi to Stavanger, the ferry to Lysebotn, the perilous van ride, and the exhausting hike. Finally, the much anticipated arrival at the exit point. And that first look into the 3,000-foot fjord. The most valued part of my trip was the characters that I met. These people have a love for their sport which is unparalleled in any other sport or activity. It is dangerous. Not dangerous like skiing or skateboarding or even motorsports are dangerous. Dangerous where a mistake will likely result in a serious injury or fatality. Two people died base jumping this year in Norway. Both tragic accidents, one right before my eyes that is etched in my mind forever. As human beings, we categorize risk. Driving on the freeway is an acceptable risk to most people because it's deemed necessary. A police officer confronting an armed robber is acceptable because that's his job and it's necessary. To these characters, jumping from a cliff is necessary. It fulfills their lives, even if it costs them their lives. I made a comparison earlier to surfers who have a saying, only a surfer knows the feeling. For a base jumper to attempt to justify his risk-taking to the uninitiated is impossible and is futile. To truly understand, one must take that step off the edge themselves. Then everything becomes very clear.